Greg Medford, Medford Knife and MKT USA. Today we're going to talk about why our big slabs of cool titanium and steel feel so good in the hand. People pick them up all the time and they say, gosh, this feels so good, I didn't expect that. That's because they're handmade. That's because every handle, every blade back, every end, corner, side has been chamfered and finished by a human hand, a craftsman, putting his hand on it, letting that part give feedback to his body where he puts it back on the machine and changes it a little bit and makes it feel just right. That process is huge. It's a big part of the cost, the expense, the care, and the final product. So why don't you guys step out on the floor with me? Let's get you a little look at that today. Come on. Okay, so to show you chamfering, why don't we start with a done knife so you can see the results of all of the work. That way when I show you the nuances of it, you kind of see how it all fits together. If you look at the end result, let's pick up some knives now and get in close with the camera and take a look at these. If you pick up some knives, what you'll see, this is a perfect knife to show you this on because it's what we call pinstriped. Around these slabs of titanium that have all of these features put on them and the sides that have been milled to exacting size, that transition from one plane to the next, this knocking this corner off is called chamfering. Now if you look at this chamfer up close, all the way around this handle, and on both sides, yeah, I can flash it in the light a little bit, and you'll notice it's on this part here. You'll notice as we come around, it's down the back of the blade here, and here, and here. Everywhere on this knife that your hand can engage, except for the razor sharp blade, which this doesn't have yet, it's a pre-sharpening box. Every part of this knife where your hand can engage has got this kind of beautiful little transition. You could think about this in building terms, maybe something that you could relate to really solidly in your own home, for instance. If you look at the transition between the floor to the wall, there's usually molding. The nicer a home is, the more elaborate that transition is. And on really high-end homes, at the top, between the wall and the ceiling, there'll be some sort of mold, an OG, or some sort of milled woodwork or some sort of molding transition. It's visual and aesthetic, and it's also really functional. Not as much on a house, it's mostly aesthetic on a house. It's functional at the bottom though, because it's the way you bring things together neatly. I mean, how would somebody bring drywall down to concrete and have them line up perfectly without turning it into an overwrought process? Whereas you put a nice piece of molding and now you've got something of your vacuum cleaner to bump up against you, and it actually shores up and kind of makes everything look tidy. It's functional and aesthetic. On a knife, it's functional and aesthetic as well. It's pleasing to the eye to not see hard corners, and hard corners are awful feeling in the hands. We knock those down and there's a really fine line. The fine line is not quite enough and it still feels blocky and rigid in the hand. Just right, it feels just right in the hand, and too much starts to impede on the functionality of some of the features. Now if you take a look in here, let's look at our grinders. Our Burking grinders, which you get, these are made in the United States. They've all got Baldor motors on them. These are made up in Missouri. This company's been really instrumental in our growth over the years. They've been really supportive, a fantastic company. And these grinders, these are not necessarily the, when I got into them, they weren't necessarily the best for a home grinder, but they're good for the commercial grinding world. They've now brought a lot of attachments in to become a little more multifunctional for a homemaker, a garage maker. Let's talk about this configuration, which is really, it's what we call the finger wheel attachment. And this is where we bring all of this power down into a really narrow wheel. We've got several different wheels we can use. We've got some small, all the way down to 1/2 inch, 5/8 of an inch, to where we can get into smaller radiuses. And we use this for when we're softening and sculpting the outside of a knife, for instance, as you can see has been done here. We also use this for running around the corners. when you're working a knife doing softening, your big wheels do your big facets, and you want to use your big wheel as much as possible. When I say your big wheel, I'm talking about your 10-inch wheel. Your 10-inch wheel is going to give you the most stability. The larger the radius is of a wheel is when you're working it, as you work your part on it, the more stable it is against your tool. So we do our what we call our big wheel work, and then we work down to the next size wheel, and then we work down to the smallest wheel last. We try to avoid, we always want to do everything with as big a wheel as is mechanically possible when we're either sculpting, softening, or chamfering. Every single part on every single knife has been chamfered, on every blade back, on every handle, on every spring, on every clip, they get softened, they get hand worked. That's how we might chamfer and knock some material away, but that still microscopically leaves a rough surface. The next thing that happens after sculpting and after chamfering, a part will come over here and get on for softening. Softening is going to use different grit abrasive wheels and buffing wheels. These are muslin wheels with different abrasive compounds that we put into the surface to give them different amounts of aggressive or not aggressive. This is all practicing, softening, and sculpting, and chamfering. These are all just different ideas on different patterns that we do, just playing around. There is a tendency for people to, you know, they see our technology and our machinery, and they'll say, oh, you know, Greg's knives are CNC made, and it's mostly a mid-tech. It's not really a mid-tech. A mid-tech is where you have your blades ground by some shop, and you have your screws made by another shop, and you have your handles made by probably another shop, and then they send them all to you, and you kind of cobble them together as best you can and deal with the tolerances and the plus minus variants with all the different people that are involved, and then maybe you put your name on it. That's one kind of mid-tech. Another kind of mid-tech is where you see that's all been done and assembled by another shop, sent to the maker, and maybe he edges it and puts a signature on it. That's a mid-tech. These are not mid-techs. These are knives that have more handwork in them than any mid-tech you'll ever encounter in your entire life. There's more hand lapping and fitting in that goes on than almost any knife you'll ever encounter. I've refused the comfort of bearings and the ease of bearings to continue to make these lapped in and bushed knives the way we make them. This hand making is really hard to extract from the level of quality that I demand from the company. So chamfering and softening, boy, I'll tell you, it's really where it's at, and it's what delivers that really handmade, high-end quality feel to every single one of our knives. All right, kids, that's chamfering and softening. It is the real handwork that goes into that beautiful, tactile, handmade American craftsman feel that all of our knives have. If you want to find out more, stop by MedfordUniversity.com. You can do a deep dive with me anytime.